We have a lot to get to, potentially, hopefully we can get to it in this video. I'm in a wow mood because of just a recent breakthrough I had. I was working on a website to complement this YouTube channel. And in the explanation of non-duality, something came to my attention as I was writing it. And it was just like, wow, I saw something that potentially is incredibly important. And so I'm just kind of shaking, trying to keep it, you know, calm. But I understand that this we could have had possibly a monumental breakthrough in non-dual understanding recognition. Put the website up here, some note or something on if you want to visit it. It's a spiffy little website, and you might enjoy it. The write-up is under the link on the main page that says non-dual. At the bottom of the home page says non-dual. Click on that link, and there's this write-up that certainly I believe you'll find it quite interesting. I find it extraordinarily important, actually. Now, there is something going on that is somewhat miraculous, inexplicable. And we can talk about that. I have this feeling like there's something going on that we need to be aware of. And it showed up in a very unusual way. I was, as I was working on this website, I was actually working on the advisors behind what we're doing here, which are, I put down as Jesus, Ramana Maharshi, and Longchenpa. I was listening to this. Somehow, this song popped into my head, saying, go listen to this song. And I said, what's the name of that song? And I kept trying to figure it out, and I said, Telstar. Yeah, Telstar. And it's like, put in the YouTube, Telstar. It's an instrumental, and it's by the Tornadoes. And I ended up listening to a playlist that was Telstar and a bunch of the Ventures and a bunch of instrumentalists and a bunch of songs from the 60s and late 60s. Really, really cool music as I was putting this page on the website together of advisors. That's also a link on the front page of the website. Okay, so I finished up late, like almost about 1 a.m. working on the website, and I went to bed. Woke up in the morning, and for some reason, I don't know why, I looked at my cell phone, and I did a double take and a triple take. I said, wait a minute, what's going on here? The day and date of my cell phone now registers, get this, it said 1/11/1970. 1/11/1970. And the time had gone back 27 minutes also. It was 27 minutes slow. This caught my attention. I know that one of our viewers had talked about memories on this getting on cell phones getting wiped clean and various things like this. And I said, what is this? And then someone today mentioned to me that all their emails had been wiped clean or blocked since last November or something. They just found out they're all gone. Okay, well. But in my instance, I started digging a little deeper. I said, what is this? And I realized it's 45 years ago. 45 years ago. And then suddenly it clicked in that I had this dream where I had this, I can't remember what the dream was. I believe I put it on one of these videos about 45 was being extremely important. And I needed to pay attention to 45, the number 45. And I looked at it as fortify. You need to fortify what you're doing. So that's what I've been doing with this website, kind of fortifying what's going on here. And yet here it is, my cell phone suddenly registers 45 years ago. Plus what? 11 plus 60, February, March. That's about less than 60 and another 15, 60, 75, whatever. But 45 years ago, suddenly the cell phone goes back 45 years before there even were cell phones. I don't know why they would even have an option to go back that far on your cell phone. But that's what it's showing. So it starts fitting in. Wait a minute. I had this very important dream with the number 45 in it. And then suddenly my cell phone goes back 45 years. I say, uh-oh, what happened on January 11th, 1970? Super Bowl number 4. Super Bowl number 4. There's the number 4 again. The fourth state. Turiya, the enlightened state, the non-dual state is called the fourth state. Okay, Super Bowl 4. Going back to 4 decades, plus the 5 years, 4.5 decades, actually. So this is quite odd, and I'm getting some other indications that lead to some questions. What's going on actually right now? Well, we're going to find out pretty soon, aren't we? As long as we will hang in here and get our answers. So have I reset the phone? No. I left it that way. And when I, 1970, I was 14 years old too. I always said that 1969 was kind of the cutoff period, and things changed in 1970. There was a change starting to happen. But suddenly we've gone back to early 1970. That was right after, of course, 1969 transitioned in 1970. And so somehow it may be indicating we are somehow rejoining the mind stream of early 1970. And why was I listening to these songs that were pre 1970 on a playlist? I never listened. That was the first time I ever listened to a playlist, someone else's playlist, I believe. You know, and I was grooving on this music that was pre 1970, actually, and saying, "Wow, what great music!" I wonder if we have been able to rejoin the mainstream in 1970 before what I say the incorporation of this planet by cosmic corporate culture began in earnest in 1970. It's been 45 years, actually, of takeover of this planet and putting their operatives in all the places that control people's attention. Okay, that controls people's attention, the newscasters, the people on the shows, the television, those who control people's attention. They have all their operatives in there right now. Many of them of the glamorous type, and this world is essentially a goner as far as being incorporated. But suddenly, go back pre-technology. Remember, this is before computers. Before personal computer was a gleam in Steve Wozniak's eye, pre-computers. Pre-computers. So, now tonight this tremendous non-dual insight arose about how to look at our situation. The fundamental mistake that we're making, maybe the fundamental mistake. 1970. And by the way, that's the time when Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma started fading out, Her influence started fading in 1970. She lasted till 1982, but her last 12 years, it seemed to be different. That was certainly a spiritual luminary, avatara, in the world at that time. It was a different time. It was a different time, wasn't it? It was just before disco hit. The mood of the world changed significantly. It was before cocaine became all the rage and all the poppers and all this, all the drugs of the disco era. It was before that, actually. It was before a lot of things happened. A lot of cultural revolutions happened. It was before the various social movements that seemed to be commonplace today, which I say were cosmic corporate culture putting their operatives in the positions that they wanted them to. It's been a 45-year global takeover and incorporation by cosmic corporate culture. It was before that. And it was a very different mindset, People were not afraid to speak their mind at that time. So this is just quite something that's taking place. And so there is this wow feeling. There's this wow feeling that is around us now. Keep in mind that what I'm saying in these videos is that the full stop in the wow, the recognition of this feeling of the wow, is the crucial key to our success. And success in what? In relaxing into non-dual abidance. It is the key. Because as we clarify and see what our situation really is, and see that our success is actually right here, right now, inescapably so, this generates sort of a feeling of trepidation because of the continuity issue, and elation because we say, oh my gosh, I'm going to be free of misery forever. And this brings up this wow feeling. It's kind of this feeling of elation and trepidation. And it's super important to recognize this and to take it easy, sit quietly. So it's very important to sit still and not be interested in give and take of dialogue and questioning and all that. We've gone past that now. This is the fourth phase. And we should be in the phase of just, wow, I'm here. I'm already here. I'm seeing that I'm going to be enlightened. It's like that. It's like when you're on fire and you're running out of the house and you're burning, your clothes are burning, you see a lake and you get close to the lake and you realize, hey, I'm going to be able to put out that fire because I'm jumping in that lake. It's like that sort of feeling. You have trepidation about that your clothes are on fire and your hair is on fire, but you also have elation that you're about ready to jump in that lake and everything's going to be fine and you're not going to catch fire like that again. It's kind of like that. So at that point, we don't stop and, for niceties about anything. I mean, we just go full bore for that lake and there's a wow feeling. It's so very important that we honor the wow feeling and not try to just ignore it. And for instance, if we have some tremendous breakthrough and clarity, is to realize we're going to have this wow feeling and don't try to just carry on as if nothing has happened and you should be able to function just the same way as before. You absolutely are not going to. It's going to interfere if you try to function that way. And then you're going to get shaky and jittery and out of sync and you say, wow, the path is too scary, difficult, and got too much problems in it. So to avoid all those problems, it's very important to practice in sitting quietly, committed to not getting up, not engaging in the give and take of the intellectual style of talking back and forth, and because you're already in the wow, you've already seen your freedom, and so, you know, honor it by saying, well, I'm elated, and I'm also have trepidation, because this is a game changer. If you don't have this wow feeling, you haven't seen deeply enough. You have to then flip the script and look to see more deeply. So I'm very much into this wow feeling right now. It's building up very intensely. For example, had dinner, then I was watching a basketball game. I said, you know what? Time to stop that. Let's not just carry on like business as usual. Let's get to some taping here. Let's get intense about this. So something is going on in the world. This is I don't believe I'm the only one who's feeling this right now. Actually, this time around March usually carries a great potency with you at the spring equinox at a time. And it certainly is playing out this way. And keep in mind, we are very much in high-speed pursuit of realization and very close to it. So, of course, we're going to feel the wow. Absolutely, that's the fourth phase. The fourth phase is all about the wow. It's all about the wow. When we meet an enlightened being, what do we do? Sit quietly and absorb the wow. Get used to the wow. This is an extraordinary situation. Even and we don't allow our intellect to try to define it for us, okay? Because you cannot define absolute freedom. It's not possible. As soon as we go into the defining aspect of our minds, we've lost the wow. We're fighting against the wow. That is not what we're suggesting here. What we're suggesting here is don't do that. No spin. Just stay with the wow. Do not go into your definitional shift into definitional thinking and analyzing sort of and measuring, etc., that part of your mental activity. Because what we're talking about is cannot be defined. Absolute freedom can never be defined. And it escapes all concepts. Because it's all always freshly liberated in the now. So when we realize we're very close to that, it's better to just abide in the wow. Abide in the wow. Full stop in the wow. So this is what this teaching's all about, is to practice full stop in the wow. Now, of course, getting the wow is part of the practice. In order to practice full stop in the wow, we need to deepen our clarity, which brings this about, and then get back to deepening it even more, which is what we call flipping the script, where we work on our clarity so we can get it even deeper. And then once we see even deeper, then it's like, wow. It was wow. And we can do that with assertions, also help a great deal with this. So we have this three-phase practice, but the centerpiece of the practice is full stop in the wow. This is what I am seeing that is crucial to go from the third phase of the spiritual path to the fourth phase. And the fourth phase then dissolves ultimately into the fourth, what's called the fourth, what do they call it? The Turiya, the fourth, Shankara's fourth type of consciousness, so to speak. Vision of oneness, vision of Christ, vision of oneness. This fourth phase practice just sort of melts and dissolves into that. Starting to get the trouble in the nose again. Suddenly it starts to give great distraction. So there's the abidance in non-dual awareness, there's deep sleep, sleep and waking sleep. Now it's a good thing if you get tormented by some sensations. Just this evening, I had this sensation on the top of my head, right at the crown of my head. Boom, pulsing. Something like little, like the hair was just being twitched or something like that. Continuously. I didn't touch it or anything. I didn't scratch it because I've had this quite a few times recently. Sort of a tingling feeling. Sort of a pulsing, tingling feeling. On and off. Now, why would suddenly this shift back to 1970 happen like this? Pre-technology, right? Prior to our attention getting hijacked, actually. Really, if you want to speak plainly, this world has been hijacked. That is correct. So this is prior to that happening, actually. Just prior to it happening. And there was, at that time, there was a lot of uncertainty about direction, but we were aware that the spiritual path was certainly a very viable direction for us. Okay. Not knowing the difficulty we would face and have faced. All right, this technology is still acting buggy, in a buggy way. The previous video dropped out. This one is doing some strange things. I don't know what to say, but it's still recording. So what are we on the verge of? We're on the verge of something right now. What's most important is to be aware of this wow issue, to identify the wow feeling, recognize it's this mixture of trepidation based on familiarity and expectation, continuity, fear, trepidation, okay, and elation, which also leads to some continuity fear, because we're just like, well, I don't know if I can handle this elation. You know, I can see how I've tricked myself. I can see my mistakes. I know I can correct them. I know this, you know, this is coming to a conclusion here. You get this wow feeling. Now, it can be somewhat subtle. But don't try to override it. Recognize it. Now, when our opportunity knocks, we already know. Full stop in the wow. practice that, the more we practice this, the faster our evaporation takes place. Don't allow the discursive mind to jump in, even with elaborate discursive displays. Because we're here, we're practicing. We have this terrible dread, actually, of annihilation. It's mistaken dread, but we have a terrible dread. And we're so used to having these habits of very fearful mind that these habits die slowly. They go away slowly. Had a dream last night that somehow I managed to solve everything. And it was quite tricky, actually. But I managed to do it. Again, I continue to have dreams where somehow I managed to resolve all problems and it's over, it's finished. As I say, it's easier for the truth to bubble up into sleep than it is to waking sleep. Waking sleep is our last line of defense. This is where our defenses are most effective. So I'm getting this tingling all throughout the crown of my head now. It's like paresthesia, kind of all over the crown of my head, in various places right now. And there's another wow. What's going on? I don't know. The website is alohawellness.wix.com/thisisit. alohawellness.wix.com/what do you put the slash? Is it forward slash or backwards? I don't know. Maybe it's a backward slash, right? Yeah. This is it. So, aloha, like it sounds, A-L-O-H-A, alohawellness.com. I'm sorry, alohawellness.wix, W-I-X.com. This is it. This is it. So I just named the website, This Is It. Because this is where we're at. This is where we're at. We're at a time when we're going to say, this is it. We want to rehearse towards this is it. When we come across that, and when we recognize this is it. This is it. You want to be ready for that. You want to be fortified for that. You want to be fortified. You want to be able to full stop in the wow. As much as possible. And do not let your discursive mind jump in and steal the spotlight. Okay? Do not allow it. I don't care how smart anybody is. Smartness is not supposed to be on stage at this point. It's the wow that's on stage. Because this is it. It's not talking about smartness at all, actually. It's talking about the fresh liberation of the now, the freshly liberated now, the inherently liberated freshness of the now. This is just pure wow. So this is it. It's just actually pure wow. And the more we see it that way, the more it evaporates our continuity fear. Okay? And when we jump in with discursiveness, and then we're spinning our wheels. We're spinning our wheels. And we're basically saying, well, this isn't it. This isn't it. That we can get some discursive answer to our to our beingness. You know, there is no question. Our beingness doesn't have any question. That's the whole point of it. Our being oneness is not flawed. It does not requiring any answers. So it's just pure wowness, absolutely pure wowness. So the next phase is this is it. When we come across the wowness, we realize this is it. I had that experience. I rented a video of the autobiography, the life. I remember the name, the life of Ananda Maima Awesome. I didn't know who it was at the time. I said, I don't know who this is. No idea, really. Just some Indian guru or something. I don't know. And then they showed a picture, showed video of her walking out of some ashram or something. And people walking along were just ecstatic. You could see they're just like, I said, what's going on? They were just beside themselves with reverence and ecstasy. And then I somehow, something within me realized, this is it. It's like that. This is it. Meaning, here is truth among us. Here is truth among us. And that's all. And then it just overwhelmed me. It became overwhelmed by it. Just spiritually overwhelmed. I couldn't even talk. I could not even talk. So this is it. This is, but you know, that was in a video. Now, we can come across this right here, right now, actually in the world, somehow, some way. And we must be ready for it, because there's an old saying, chance favors the prepared mind, is a tongue-in-cheek saying. Meaning opportunity favors the prepared. Okay. So there is not even a question of asking questions at this point. It's just all about the wow. It's all about the wow. And when we really be patient with it, and just keep breathing and remain steady, trying to keep ourselves steady, keep your mind steady in the wow, full stop in the wow. Work on just keeping the mind steady so it doesn't jump into discursiveness and questioning and various things. Keep it just steady. And this is it. I know this is it, and I'm just going to be steady with that. This is when we make the real progress. Because this is when we're getting used to. This is when familiarity sets in for us. And once familiarity has set in, you know, we've won the game. We've won. We've turned the tide. So what we're really trying to do is turn the tide. This is what we're really trying to do. And we can do it. We can do it. But it requires this steady sitting, the steadiness. This quietness, the stillness. Once you see the situation, we don't have any doubt. It deep down, we don't have any doubt. It's not a question of that. It's a question of familiarity and expectation, trepidation and elation, and the wow feeling. That's all. But as far as doubts, no, we don't. I don't have any doubts about non-dual abidance. But we can get fooled into thinking that this wow feeling means we have some sort of doubt. No, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that, actually. It's like, what if you were in the pitch dark and suddenly a light went on and you saw everything and you said, wow, I didn't know all this stuff was here. I mean, this is incredible. I mean, I'm looking out now, it's pitch dark. I don't see anything. What if the sun suddenly, you know, came up and there's someone turned on a light and I'm seeing everything, and all the colors, everything's here. I'm just like, wow, I didn't even know it was there. And then what if they flick the light off then? Are you going to start thinking, now, wait, what happened? How come I did this? No. You know what happened. The light just went on. You saw what is there, and now you know it's there. And you know there's a light that can go on. So just deal with that fact. As I say, don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. Do not doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. So you merely just say, it really is there. I really did see it. I really am here. You know, it's like we're worried, where's home? We're already home. It's just that we don't see it. And then to suddenly see it for a moment, then you realize, hey, I am home. And just sit with that. And the wow feeling will certainly arise. Because, of course, our expectations, our familiarities, the darkness, our expectations are that we will be in this darkness for a long, long, long time to come. And it just won't resolve like right away like this. That's our expectations. So we need to change our expectations and familiarity by just sitting here and saying, yeah, I expect this. I expect to succeed. I expect this wow. And just sit in it. Sit in this buzz, sit in this feeling of wow. So I would submit to everyone that there is sufficient reason to believe that there is something going on in the world that is certainly worthy of wow right now. And when I say this world, let's just realize that this means the totality, not just our forgetfulness, levels of forgetfulness, that are just mental forgetfulness, actually, mental belief. There's something going on beyond our mental belief. In spite of our mental belief, there is the grace of God is at play here somehow. The grace of the bodhisattvas, the grace of the saviors, the grace of the gurus, the grace of the avatars, this is at play right now. This is at play, and we don't know how it's going to play, do we? What's next? Now, another very odd situation occurred today. Well, I was at some place, and there was somebody that was there, and somebody pulled up in a truck and came walking toward me, and they had this kind of sort of really pushy, odd attitude. And I looked at him and I said, what's going on here? Something very odd is going on here. And kept asking questions and kept walking right past me. And then it ended up that this person that came in the truck ended up kind of talking to this other person that was working there in kind of back and forth sort of aggressive ways. Back and forth aggressive ways. And they look, and the funny thing was, they looked just like one another. They seemed like the same person. And I noticed this, and I said, wow, what is going on here? Later on, one of my friends who was there came up to me, and he said, hey, when I saw this guy first get out of the truck, I had the intuition that he was like, it came here specifically to talk to this other person. They're like, you know, cousins or twins or something. This guy came here and was going to do just that. I had this intuition he's going to do just that. And I said, wow, I felt the same way. And we both said, that was very odd, wasn't it? So it seems as though there is some sort of meta play taking place now, that's starting to emerge. I would submit that whatever it is to come is starting to emerge. The apocalypse is starting, which means the veil is being lifted. Some other conversations today too that were very different and extraordinary, that leads me to believe the veil is being lifted right now. And I've been under a lot of urgency to put together the website. Maybe that's why the camera failed and I've had trouble with my videos. I used to have a website, but it was on another free website builder, which was lousy, and it ended up, after like 5 visits to the page, it stopped. You couldn't visit it anymore. They just had an advertisement there, and I said, this just won't work for anybody. It's just terrible. So I didn't know what to do. I finally went over to Wix, and it wouldn't work for me at all. I couldn't even load the HTML5 editor. But finally, I went back and I tried it one more time, and it loaded. And then I said, well, let me try this. And it actually turns out to be quite nice. I'm able to build pages and website quite beautifully and quickly. And so there's something about that. I feel like that needs to be present. I feel that the apocalypse is upon us now. March, spring equinox of 2:15. I just have this feeling. And I wonder if some of you don't have this feeling as well in your lives. You start to recognize that something subtly is going on, more so than normal. It's and we should not try to define it too much, but there's a wow feeling. And what happens in your life may have some kind of very seemingly strong significance. You know, whether it's numbers that keep popping up, which certainly have been tremendous for me. The number 4 and 44 have just been overwhelmingly tremendous and continue on and on and on. The situations that you see. So... be aware, be alert, and above all else, recognize this wow feeling, okay? And be humble, be severely modest, be humble, and don't allow yourself to get carried away with enthusiasm. Recognize the way to deal with the wow feeling is be quiet, be still. Don't try to do too much. Don't overdo what you do. Give yourself patience, give yourself some quietness, so you can really be in touch with it. another conversation with someone I'd never talked to before. I just went over and talked with him. His car wasn't there. And there was a pickup truck instead. And I said, "What happened to your car?" He says, "Oh, I'm afraid to, I don't want to bring it here anymore. I'm afraid it might get bumped or scratched." And so we had a conversation, and he mentioned he's building a house right by Pebble Beach, Carmel Pebble Beach. And he says, "Oh yeah, it's really good getaway for the kids and get out of the Silicon Valley. It's really good to get out of here." You know, and his other car is a very expensive car, to say the least. And he said, "No, I'm leaving that at home. I just got this pickup truck instead. I'm gonna drive that around." I know the place he was talking about in Carmel. It's sort of like this ideal getaway sort of situation. Now, going back to 1970, that's certainly an ideal getaway from Silicon Valley. Technology, Silicon Valley didn't exist at that time, really, did it? In fact, there wasn't really a reason to get away. Everything was so different then. We'd go to Carmel, but it wasn't so much to get away. It's just to more enjoyment, so to speak, more enjoyment. But now people are saying, "Well, man, we got to, you know, this place isn't good for the kids. We got to get them out of here. Give them a break from this place," actually, which is true. But how do you get a break from technology? Yeah. Well, you limit it as much as possible. One thing is to keep an old flip phone instead of a smartphone. That's the one of the best moves you can make, actually. I just use it for calls the same way I'd use a telephone. That's it. And if I have to text, I'll text. But that's rare. So it's just simply the same as a telephone. And that's it. We use this simple webcam, little headset with just a microphone, which we've had for a long time in the world, and then the computer to, you know, put it up on the YouTube server. That's it. Now, non-dual. Believe it. We have some very strong heavyweights working on our behalf right now, spiritually working for our welfare, and they believe we can do it. They certainly did it. They know it's just a mistake we're making. There is a mistake we're making, misinterpretation, that leads to fear where it doesn't need to lead to fear at all, actually. We end up compounding our fears by not recognizing the wow, actually, is the, I believe, the most injurious compounding. It's the mistake we make that compounds our fears pragmatically more than anything, because we can see the mistake we've made, but then the wow comes up, and if we don't recognize the wow for what it is, we're going to think that it's fear, and that just makes a feedback loop to the mistake and actually reinforces the mistake, and then we back off and say, "Oh, that can't be it. I'm going to go in a different direction." This is why I say to succeed in this fourth phase practice, it is so important to recognize this wow. The feeling, the wow feeling, so important to recognize it. So you don't retreat, so you don't back off. So you don't say, "Oh, this can't be it. You know, this is making me more fearful." Then we end up compounding our mistakes, very much so. then we become goal-oriented. You see, reality's not a goal. There's no goal orientation in reality whatsoever. It's not like that. Now, on the website, there's an explanation of the new insight. Again, homepage is AlohaWellness.wix.com. This slash, I guess that would be just an ordinary slash. I think it's backwards. Slash. This is it. This is it. So AlohaWellness.wix.com/. This is it. Click on the link near the center bottom of the page. Says non-dual on it. Non-dual. You'll get a little surprise when you click on that page. And you'll also get an explanation. Very interesting explanation. And it will most likely produce a wow. If you're tuned into it, you will get to say, oh my gosh. Is this it? You know, is this it? Is this clarity? This could, you know, this is a feeling like I say, oh wow, this is it. Wow. The curtain has been pulled aside. The curtain has been pulled aside. And then you can cool down by browsing through the rest of the site. I can't promise everything will remain static on there. I'm always changing stuff, improving. I'm always improving. But I just want to throw something up there just because I feel the time is right, that we are going to be, the curtain is going to be pushed aside for us. Somehow the curtain is going to be pushed aside, and that is when, wow. Yeah, here's an example. Let's say we've been sitting in this theater for millions and millions and millions and millions of years, staring at a curtain. And, you know, after all that sitting, aren't we familiar with the curtain? And aren't we familiar, expect the curtain to be there? And in fact, we don't even know it's a curtain. We think this is reality, right? There's no reason to think otherwise, hardly, right? Now, let's say suddenly, the curtain just parts. And behind the curtain is all this incredible, you know, astonishing show going on. What would be our reaction to this? Would it not be just this amazing wow? So all we're doing here is, you might say, we're telling ourselves the curtain is going to part. That's a curtain. I know it's a curtain. Behind the curtain is what I really want to see, and the curtain is about ready to part. You no longer think that this is just reality. This is the way it is. That the curtain, there's nothing but the curtain. Now you realize, oh, this is just a temporary obscuration that I'm looking at. It's not reality at all. It's a temporary obscuration of belief. And that obscuration is about to go poof. So this is where we generate the anticipation, right? Now, let's say there's some show that you're really looking forward to and the curtain is there and you're in your seats and everybody's just humming and buzzing. The anticipation builds and builds and builds, and especially like if it's behind the curtain, there's, you know, back in the 60s, the Beatles, you know, or behind the curtain. I mean, the people would be screaming and yelling and just caring, like, oh, they can't, the anticipation's just driving them crazy, you know. So the behind the curtain is the truth, is what we want to see. Vision of oneness. So we have this anticipation building up here. This is wow. Part elation, part trepidation. Can I handle it? Can I handle the intensity? Can I handle the elation? I don't know how I'm going to feel. This is really something. So it's like a really big show is about to take place. The apocalypse is about to take place. Lifting of the veil, parting of the curtain. In many, 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 many levels, maybe the entire thing, the entire situation is about ready to unfold in ways that we have not even hardly, well, we've dreamt of them, but we have not pulled it so much into waking sleep. In our sleep, we keep going through all sorts of amazing stuff, right? I mean, my dreams are just showing me that resolution is coming, that all problems are being solved, and we're in for some really quite a ride. So in our waking sleep here, we need to prepare for this and get ready for it. It's kind of like in California, we get ready for the drought. We know the drought is going to hit us like a runaway freight train here, and most people are oblivious to it. But if you're aware of it, then you can start preparing for the wow of it. You know, wow. I'm already doing that to a very large extent, trying to adjust my mind to a different California now, actually. It's really apocalypse in California is coming on strong. Now, the wealthy will just move. Wealthy, there are people who are able to just move easily. It's really quite extraordinary. I guess when you're used to money and managing money and all that, it's not such a big deal to just swing business deals and say, oh yeah, okay, I'll buy a house here, sell this one, and just move right on. You know, it's just quite something. So they may realize, hey, the property values here are going to plummet. There's no potable water. You know, turn the tap on, there's nothing there. That's not very good of your property value. And so, and the yard's all dying and going to die and everything. They'll just move to some other part of the world. And eventually, California may just be populated by, you know, desperate people. Poor, very poor, desperate people. Who are used to living in dry, dusty, hot, super poor, you know, desperate conditions. You know, North Mexico, you might call it, Northern Mexico. It's going to be something like that, actually. It's quite possible, the way things are going. We'll turn back to just the barren cattle ranches of the past. Like Los Angeles was just desperately dry scrubland, actually. All Southern California was super dry. So, this is one apocalypse, but the lifting of the veil on truth is way, 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 way bigger deal. Immeasurably bigger deal. Now, 1970 was before I fell terribly ill, actually. It was before all my troubles began, for the most part. There were some precursors to it, but from the 1970s standpoint, we can certainly reconnect with right focus, right emphasis, right placement of the wow. As I've said, cosmic corporate culture, what they're very clever what they do. They misplace and displace the wow, which gets you to then pursue their goals, thinking that that's where you're going to find the what's causing the wow. See, this is it. What's causing the wow ultimately is truth. Whereas when they displace the wow, they make you think that buying things and doing things and being goal-oriented is how you is going in the direction of the what's causing the wow. And this is absolute self-deception is what they're engaged in. I call them, they're Antichrist, plain and simple. Keep in mind that reality is flawless. There is no flaw in reality whatsoever. There's no flaw anywhere. Right this instant, there's not one single flaw happening anywhere. Nothing is out of place. Nothing is wrong. No flaws are taking place whatsoever. Everything is perfect this very instant. And this instant too. And this instant too. And each instant is absolutely, inherently, freshly liberated from all. It is in one within itself, totally, totally fresh and new, totally fresh and new. There's nothing wrong at all. We're already abiding in the pure land. Everyone is already abiding in heaven right now. This is the wow. This is what the wow that we're, the origin of it is we're going to, back to realizing this truth, whereas we've been trying to prove that reality has a flaw, and now we're going back to realizing it doesn't. But what the world, the delusion, self-delusion is they're still gung-ho about proving that reality has a flaw, and so their goal of attainment is to somehow attain that proof. To accomplish, and they believe they have to accomplish something, then transcend the flaw, and then therefore prove they're greater in reality. Transcending reality with a flaw it would mean you're better than, greater than reality with a flaw. So they're goal-oriented, very much goal-oriented, where we are not, because we realize reality doesn't have any flaw at all. So there's nothing we need to do. We don't need to fix anything. We don't need to fix reality. We don't need to transcend reality. We don't need to transcend anything. We're already dwelling in the pure land. What do we need to transcend? Everything's already perfect. So the world, the cosmic rubber culture displaces the wow feeling, turns it towards attainment, accomplishment, goal-oriented mentation, all of that. And then also rewards for pursuing that. And this is where people think the wow is taking them. This is where what it's coming from. And so they pursue these objectives, not realizing that they're feeling this wow. They're not so conscious of it. Not realizing where the wow truly comes from and where they must trace it back to. Okay, and this is the problem in the world. So since the last 45 years, there's been this extraordinary shifting of the wow feeling off of its rightful place in our recognition onto secular humanist, consumerist, corporate consumerist goals that cosmic corporate culture has for this planet. This is, they want us to be all good corporate citizens here. Not spiritual citizens, corporate citizens. And they have vast armadas of operatives here who are all chirpy and perky and glamorous and telling you how corporate citizenship is, what a privilege it is, they say. You know, how great I feel being a great corporate citizen. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I mean, it's like the welcome wagon. They have all these hostesses, welcome wagon hostesses, saying, we're so happy that you have finally become an ideal corporate citizen, and we're going to help you and reinforce you and make sure that you never fall away again from this ideal. And, you know, wow. You know, we're back in the 1950s in some ways, to tell you the truth. It's amazing. It's amazing what happens when this corporate mentality takes hold and all these hostesses pop out of the woodwork and they're just these model corporate hostesses, you know, just like, come on into my house and look what corporations can do for us and how wonderful, happy I am and how wonderful, you know, it's just like we went looped right back into that. We were just looped right back into it. But now it's way more powerful, and basically we're institutionalizing it to such an extraordinary extent that it seems inescapable. And we're labeling that as, finally we're getting it right. Finally we're having a kind, just, righteous society. We finally learned that corporate society is for us. Being a corporate citizenship is for us. Yeah, we finally got it. And everyone's celebrating this. And there's all these cheerleaders just saying, wow, world, you're finally getting it. Leaving behind that terrible, barbaric resistance that used to have, that we're not even going to talk about it because it stinks so bad we don't even want to bring it to mind. We're just cheering and celebrating that we're all finally getting it and being realizing that the great privilege of corporate citizenship. It's like citizens of a super Roman Empire, so to speak. And the Christians are going to, you know, they're finally driven down in the catacombs, and this time we're going to crush them for good. And I mean that Christians loosely mean religious, not just religious, spiritually minded people. Meaning people who have the wow placed in the right place. Okay. So Christianity was formed with the wow that people were having toward Jesus. I mean, Jesus generated an enormous wow in this world. So much so that just seeing him at a distance, it's just like, just your mind was just wowed, completely wowed out. And just completely, it just changed your life, just like that. He said, my life can never be the same. I'm aware of something that just has just struck me. He said, this is it. This is it. And so that generated a whole bunch of momentum by those who had seen this, and then the apostles were also not as potent that way, but they were also doing a tremendous amount of miracles and generating a tremendous amount of wow. And then this ran into the Roman Empire. Of course, the Roman Empire wanted the wow to be on their buildings and their what they have accomplished, what they, you know, their cleverness, their goal-oriented behavior, their purposeful behavior, their ability to, you know, their bureaucracy and their own idols they called gods and goddesses and all this. They wanted the wow to be on that. Look at this control we have. Look at this structure we have. Look at this civilization we have. They wanted the wow to be on that. Antichrist. So, obviously, the Romans didn't like the early Christians. Hunted them down like rats. They had to go underground into the catacombs, which I guess were the burial grounds of Rome, and just massive mazes of tunnels, and also they had a water system, I guess, under aqueducts underground too, and tunnels, and so they hid underground and would come up only to come into some houses, you know, safe houses. They had safe houses that they could meet in, kind of not a very happy lifestyle. And for a while, tolerance would build a little bit, and then someone would come along and say, crack down on them. They all had to flee back underground and into hiding again. So when the wow factor first arrives, this is it. It's very potent. You know, after thousands of years of the ego spinning it, it loses some of its potency among most, but the freshness of it, coming across this freshness of it, this is it. It's very potent, wow. And doubt is swept aside. Doubt is swept aside. You don't have to deal with so many doubts anymore. But you do have to deal with this elation and trepidation, the wow, that you do have to deal with that. Don't just try to nonchalant it, use spiritual gamesmanship. That doesn't get you anywhere. Just acknowledge it, embrace it, and say, yeah, this is great. This is a tremendous wow. For instance, with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, I guess I was hit with this avalanche of wow. You know, it was just tremendous wow in me. There's no doubt in my mind that this was some, this was appearance of pure truth in the world. You know, absolutely, I was completely saw it through and through, absolutely certain of it. And so I kept trying to tell everybody, and everybody would say, oh yeah, she's a nice lady. Yeah, she's very beautiful. You know, most people say, oh, look at, she's a beautiful, she's really, has a lot of physical beauty. You know, that's how they related to her, is she's beautiful. And I'm saying, what, are you kidding me? I mean, this is, this is abidance in non-dual truth, you know, among us, to an extraordinary extent. This is it, you know. This is life. This is truth. You know, this is our life here. We're seeing our true life right here. But you know, people didn't see that. They just said, "Oh yeah, she seems like a nice lady." Yeah. So not everybody gets the, you know, the full, you know, this is it experience. But if you're spiritually attuned, you come across. I just looked at the taping. It's 111, 111:21, 111:22, 111:23. Wow, very interesting. 111 is 3111. This is the dream I had quite some time ago about this collapse of a mountain on right onto Highway 111. Which goes through Palm Springs, Highway 111. Sudden, incredible collapse, and a rollout, 111. I've also been seeing a lot of 1111s too, a lot of 1111s, 111, 1111s, it's just amazing. There is something spiritually going on beneath the surface right now that it seems to be building to a crescendo, which may be the parting of the curtain. Now, wherever we can find this wow correctly placed onto the truth and the fact that how easy it is to simply be where we already are. You know, we don't need to do anything. The clarity, wherever we can find that wow, we've got to seek it out. We have to find it, and we have to keep experiencing it. We have to keep getting used to it. Because this is the situation's about ready to kick into high gear right now. The man I was talking to, about his car, he says, I don't want to bring it here anymore. He says, it might get scratched, it might get bumped, the place isn't safe anymore for it. I feel like it's not safe in the parking lot. And I said, wow. It's a $200,000 car. $200,000 plus, actually. And he said, no, I'm just leaving it in the garage at home because I just feel like it's not safe anymore. Quite an interesting statement. So he just got a rough and tumble pickup truck. And, you know, there were tough times, in other words. So this $200,000 car is like this, and just, it seems like, you know, it's like spirit, you know, it's just amazing. Maybe this world is about to get too tough and rough for those of us who, you know, want to focus on truth, on spirit. I don't know how, but there's something like this. See, these clues are coming up. It's better to perhaps retreat at this time and not be so out in the, well, it's better to focus in on the wow than it is to focus in on social issues, I would say. So every time my mind starts to go into these social issues, and I get very upset about it because I know what's happening. I know how cosmic corporate culture has deceived, is so severely deceptive, and all these cheerleaders and hostesses and operatives of cosmic corporate culture are feeling like they're so completely in the right. At congratulating everybody. Everyone's basically, it's just like this huge collective congratulations. Congratulations, we finally made it into cosmic collective culture. We're now good corporate citizens, you know, and everybody's feeling like they've graduated. And so we're feeling like, oh my gosh, you know, we're not graduating. You know? Maybe it's better to have some situation where we're meeting in a low-key way, you know, and begin to reinforce this wow where it's supposed to be. Just like this man is leaving his $200,000 car in his garage at home, and he'll drive it around some, he said, but he doesn't want to park it in public parking lots anymore. He says, I just feel uneasy, and in fact, somebody slashed the two front tires of someone's car in the parking lot just recently. As long as also some during the daytime, you know, things are getting a little too wild, and he just suddenly decided, "Nah, I'm not going to do it anymore." Wow. Now, a truck, of course, you expect to get beat up, beat on, and all that's okay. That's no problem. That's your truck. You know, you get dents and dings and scratches in your truck. That's fine. That's great. You know, that's what the trucks are for. So, you know, so he said, I'm going to use that vehicle at this time now. But still have the other one. He said, I'm not selling it. I'm not getting rid of it. I'm still going to have it. So, yeah, I wonder. Maybe we should not expect some great teacher to come in and suddenly, you know, take a central role in the spiritual politics of the planet and stuff like that. I don't, you know, it's likely to be much lower key than that. That only those who are clued into it are going to know about it, actually. It's not going to be, you know, obvious to the hoi polloi, you know, of the world, the corporate activists, you know, the operatives who are so busy trying to get the whole globe to graduate into, you know, into corporate citizenry. Of course, they're obsessed with this. So, you know, you cannot try to put it into that context because it doesn't fit at all. So those people are continuing pell-mell. They're just going for broke on this whole thing. And then the rest of us will have a more a situation where we're able to focus in on something that, well, this is it. This is really it. You know, graduating the cosmic corporate culture, that's not it. That's not really it at all. It's not really it at all. Even though there's a bunch of bells and whistles there, right? And perks, bells and whistles, and very superficial stuff, actually. Just like the new smartwatch that they're going to put out, you know, very superficial stuff. Oh, gee, I can check hotel rooms on my wristwatch or something. I mean, it's just, what can we do to make it seem like we're not being so superficial? And the more they keep doing all that stuff, the more superficial they are, actually. Don't need to try and be like some sort of uber efficient, you know, because that's goal-oriented, this super goal-oriented mentality of this world now. And that's the very thing you need to set down, actually, for non-dual realization, is this whole goal-orientedness. The goal is to realize there is no goal. There's no need for any goal at all. Never has been. There's nothing to transcend. There's absolutely nothing to transcend. Because there's nothing wrong. Everything is already perfect. So there's not even any motive to transcend. So we must set down the whole goal of transcendence, actually. Which is ultimately plays out as this world and all its goal-oriented activity. So I hope you enjoy the website. It's here for you. You know, it's kind of a little a place to go. And I may fiddle around with it a lot. You never know. WWW, of course, is always there. It's Aloha Wellness, A-L-O-H-A Wellness, AlohaWellness.wix.com/thisisit. And so I'm just putting it up there with the feeling that we're about ready to commence something. We're about ready to commence something. In some way, those who have prepared in this world, we're not saying us in specifically are special or anything at all, but I'm just saying those who have prepared in the world, somehow, something is about ready to commence. That this is it is about ready to commence. So do not let up on your preparation right now, okay? Above all else, continue your preparation. Cognizant of the wow feeling, that the wow feeling is going to be building up within you. And so keep the lid on that. You know, continue to be patient and self-disciplined. Poised in full stop in the wow. Don't let it run away. Don't let it get displaced. My cosmic corporate culture is saying, "Oh, look, wow! You can go shopping here. Wow! You know, there's all the stuff. I see it. I can hardly believe it anymore. It's so campy. You know, the whole culture is so utterly campy and ludicrous, actually, and pathetic, and just simply untenable." What a great excuse to click, you know, turn it off. That's the perfect excuse to turn it all off like that. So AlohaWellness.wix.com/thisisit. Maybe it's a forward slash. Maybe I can't remember. Just it's funny, if I was at the computer, of course I could get it. You know, so if one slash doesn't work, do the other one. It's easy process of elimination. So feel free to comment at this time. About what's happening in your life. Are you starting to recognize, you know, you're getting this feeling? Where's your wow feeling coming from? This is what we need to start asking ourselves now. Where is your wow feeling coming from right now? You should always have some wow feeling in you. I've had that for the least last 45 years, and even more than that, actually, probably. But that's a nice figure you want to use. Always there's some wow. I've always been finding the next big thing, the next big thing, the next big thing to generate this wow, keep the wow on track. So where is your wow feeling coming from right now? The positive wow. Or even if something's terrible, you might be saying, "Wow, I don't like this. I'm deciding that I'm going to free myself from this delusion. You know, I'm going to be free of misery. Some way. Anyway, where is your wow coming from? Where is your wow coming from? What sort of things are taking place, in your life? What are you noticing? What are you noticing? What are you noticing? So feel free to comment on the videos now at this point. I've been able to push things forward enough at this point where the momentum is sufficient now that, I feel that people can comment and say, what is happening? What is happening? What is happening with your life? Where is your wow coming from? Start to be very observant, very aware right now. Not about world news. I don't watch the news. Don't pay attention to the news. Don't really know what's going on. Hardly at all. Because my wow's not coming from there. Someone said, oh, there's riots here, riots there. I just don't even pay attention, whatever. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Use that just to crunch, this false wowness. I mean, wowness being put into false places. And find out where it's coming from in a spiritual way. So for me, like, it's not that the baseball season's starting in 14 days, but who's counting anyway? That's not the wow. You see, that's just like a little wow. But no, that's not the wow. The wow is, this is it. I mean, this is it. Is seems to be emerging. So we're told that at the end of the age, there will be many that will be enlightened. Right? This is the time. So this is it. We should expect it. And enlightenment is much easier than we've previously thought about, because it has nothing to do with reaching any goal. It has to do with dropping the believed in need to attain anything. And when we do that, we realize we're already it. We're already perfect. We're already flawless. All is already flawless. Reality is already flawless. We're it. All is it. Already it. There's nothing we need to do. And so we're getting close to this. Now, the Christians, many Christians think they're going to be out here by September 23rd, 2:15. We'll see. Where's here, out of here, Well, it's possible that there's a relocation situation scenario coming up. But again, we're already in the Pure Land. We're already in the Kingdom of Heaven. Everyone is, actually. It's impossible to ever be anywhere else. So we certainly don't need to attain that, so to speak. But from a pragmatic standpoint, based on belief systems and the whole continuity problem situation, there might be, a place where we feel less pressured to be insane. That's possible. This speaking of pressuring people to be insane, the big corporate companies, one of the big push of cosmic corporate culture right now on this planet is to put all these tablets and smartphones of all different sizes and varieties, et cetera, into the hands of 2-year-olds, basically, as young as possible. This is the big push that's taking place now in this world. This is a new babysitter. You see these little kids, 2-year-olds, they're showing them now. And they're just completely obsessed with what's on their smartphone or their tablet. And I've seen it, personally seen this now. And the kid is just sitting there mesmerized by it. 2-year-olds mesmerized by it. So they're getting them as young as 2-year-olds, as young as possible. What is happening now in the world. And so how do you think the world is going to go here in the future? Right? You don't need to even think about that one. Not our problem at this point. Okay, down the road, I mean, ultimately, bodhisattvas, saviors, sages, masters, gurus, whatever you want to say, will certainly help and lend a hand and you know, help these wake up, the ones that have been steeped in darkness, help them, you know, wake up to truth. But right at this point, let's say that's not really our problem. You know, the immediate future of the world is not our problem. They're busy making their bed, and then once they lie in it for a while, they may say, I can't really sleep in this bed very well. So I want to get out of this bed, but what do I do? Help, you know. It's like the 50s. Everybody thought the 50s was like perfect. All these perfect homemakers and mothers and who touting the corporate line, like, look at my new vacuum cleaner and my new, you know, washing machine, a new car. We just like absolutely ecstatic, you know, we're completely ecstatic. And after, you know, after a while, the 50s, people just got burned out and said, wow, this isn't it. This isn't the wow I was really looking for. And then, you know, people started looking for spiritual answers. And or turning to drugs. We had a bunch of ganja heads, a bunch of guys and gals come from the Europe and the U.S. go over to India, and of course there's a bunch of sadhus over there that are, use ganja and hashish as a sacrament, you know, thinking that somehow that's where they should get their wow from it. They, you know, talk about spinning your wheels, being stuck in a rut. That's not it. And so these folks went over, you know, and started, you know, the wild, got real wild, the wild hippies, and started, you know, doing all these dances and rituals and ecstatic kind of so-called, actually drug-induced, false wow, ecstasy stuff, and came back with that and started introducing drugs to the culture, along with our friends, the rock and rollers. Yeah. And so that's a severely misplaced wow. Severely misplaced wow. Like, wow, look what these drugs can do for you. Wow. See, that is Antichrist. Okay, that's a misplacement of the wow. Okay, the wow needs to be recognized as coming from our recognition of non-dual abidance, seeing how we've tricked ourselves. Seeing the mistake, realizing we're very close to being done with it forever. Because we actually have the clarity, we're actually recognizing and seeing it. That's the proper place for the wow. The proper place for the wow is on the enlightened ones, like, who have already done it and who have the presence of it. Okay, that's the proper place for the wow, the presence of it, the truth of it, the clarity of it. That's where the wow has to be for us to awaken, not on sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Of course, when the pill came out, the sexual revolution hit in the world, and the women just went completely bonkers, and everybody just saying, wow, you know, wow. And so the wow got displaced onto sex, onto drugs, and onto rock and roll, and the combination of all three, actually, which was, again, diabolical, Antichrist, absolutely, because it's a severe misplacement of the wow. And then you start searching in that direction for the answer, you know, more, more, more. And things get worse, 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 actually. You know, in those ashrams of those great realizers, very strict. There's none of this nonsense. They make sure the wow is not displaced. It is very important that the wow not be displaced, that it maintain its proper placement, the wow towards realization that you're very close to awakening. Because the fact is, we're all very close to awakening. We're just one simple recognition away from awakening, actually, from dropping this nonsense, from losing all fear, for fear disappearing forever. We're just one simple recognition away. And so we have to be, you know, this is where the wow has to be. This is where it comes from. still recording. That's very nice. AlohaWellness.wix.com/this is it. I couldn't tell you if my life depended on whether there's a forward or backward slash, but I can probably find out some way on this computer right now. Let me see if this will work. Or has this messed up the whole thing? No, I can't get it that way. It should show where it's captured to. I can't see that. So, the internet's not on right now. That's strange. This is a little bit of... I could go on the internet, but it might knock this out. Let me see. No, I can't get it. It's going to remain a mystery for me, which will only be solved after this video. Forward or backward slash. I don't know. Why isn't there a setting here for... Okay, it just must get rid of it. This is just a way to kind of let the wow... settle it. We're just kind of spending a little time here. It's been so intense. The video's been so intense. If I had to guess, I'd say a forward slash. If I had to guess. But then I think about it, it seems wrong. You see, you talk about a silly little thing like that. You can't remember. That's great. Okay, well, we don't want to dwell in this. Gotten a little goofy here, which shows the intensity of the wow. We don't want it to get goofy. So watch that in your life. If you really feel yourself getting goofy, just say, hey, wait a minute, that must be the wow is so intense that I'm letting it get away from me, and then make a concerted effort to pull it back. And to be get refocused and poised, regain your poise. Don't go goofy. Don't go silly. There's a tremendous amount of goofiness and silliness in the world right now by the cosmic corporate hostesses and operatives who want you to by all means, they're trying to keep. To divert you away from the wow, the feeling of the wow, this elation and trepidation over recognizing you're only one simple recognition away from eternal happiness and having fear vanish forever. They want you to keep being goofy and silly and be distracted. Go shopping, be goofy, be silly, giggle, and do stupid things and be trivial. So all the stuff on television is just, it's so ridiculous. I can't even look at it. And they're telling you, this is the way good corporate citizens behave now. You see, here's a good example of how we want you to be. Then, you know, just say, what are you talking about? These people are like, I don't even want to say what they're like. It's like they're asleep. shallow, to say the least. It's like, who can be the most shallow? It's kind of a competition in the world. Who can be the most shallow? And sometimes shallowness is it's so over the top, it's farcical, and that's pretty funny. Like the Nathan's hot dog eating contest, you know, someone eating 65 hot dogs and buns in 10 minutes, you know, and it's just, it's farcical. It's so over the top. I get a kick out of that. It just sort of highlights just how ludicrous, you know, it's the the ludicrousy of it all. And it's kind of like, say, wow, I don't want to be doing that. That's certainly, I don't want my future to be like that. What did Longchenpa say when he left this world in spite of all his Dzogchen clarity? He said, I'm overjoyed. I've never been so happy as to leave this world, go to the death-free realm. Never been so happy. This is, you know, this is the ultimate. I'm just overjoyed. So, you know, don't think that this world is someplace that we feel like we want to stay forever, you know. In spite of seeing the perfection of it at all, realizing this is the pure land. All is the pure land. Usually the enlightened ones choose not to hang around here forever, right? There may be something far, 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 far more wonderful calling us in terms of the scope of our experiencing. That is for sure. That Telstar keeps going, that song keeps going through my mind. By the Telstar, by the Tornadoes, T-E-L-S-T-A-R. I don't know what that's about. There was a crescent moon last night with Venus very close in the evening sky. It's like, wow, beautiful. Huh? What's going on here? Telstar, star that tells us something. Telstar, star that tells us something. That star, the telephone, telling me something. Start, 111. 111, 111, oneness, 1970, oneness in 1970, wow, oneness in 1970, I want to check in, what was happening with 1970, I mean, I remember transcendental meditation was probably starting to move in this direction in 1970, I know it was really big in 1975, for sure, I know that. But maybe there was people started, maybe may have been doing a lot of meditating then, actually, in 1970. That was very much in vogue then. I know the Beatles went and saw Maharishi, what was it, 1966 or so? 66, was it? 67, somewhere around, you know, somewhere around that time. Maybe it was a little later than that. Maybe it was 69. I don't know. I'll look into it. But meditation was being brought to the collective consciousness of the planet. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi was doing a lot of that, and I'm not sure when the Hare Krishna movement started, but there was this. Yeah, I'll look into some of this. I'll look into the 1970. You know what was going on? 1970, actually. Maybe we were saying, you know what? I think it's time to get serious about the spiritual path. That may have been it. Maybe 1970. We said, you know, it's this make or break. We need to make a decision. How am I going to spend the next 45 years, so to speak? Of course, I know many of you are not here at that time, but just bear with me on this, because there was a decision to be made. Are we going to go with cosmic corporate culture? Or are we going to go with spiritual culture, enlightenment culture? Is the question. Now it's a big quest, you know, to decide you're going to go for it. You know, wow, that's a huge commitment. Talk about commitment. Wow. That's the ultimate in commitment. And, you know, I knew I had a tough road ahead, and it turned out to be just that. Very tough. But here we are, late March 2015, or is it 1970, actually? Which is the right time? Or do we get to decide what time it is, actually? Maybe it's up to us to decide what time it really is. And ultimately, we have the right to say that it's right, the time is right now. In fact, there's no time. If every moment is liberated, absolutely fresh and clean, cleanly liberated, cleanly fresh, how can we say that there's time? What meaning does that have? Time has to do with the counting of supposed stringing together of moments that are somehow bound together. But no moments are actually bound together. So what meaning does time actually have? Just a question to you know, just let it sit there. The answer is obvious. Don't even have to answer it. So it's better to not even answer the questions. You know, when I raise a rhetorical question, just let it sit there. Or when any rhetorical question arises in your, you know, mentation, clarity, and just let it sit there. It's always now. And maybe in 1970 we were a lot closer to realizing that than the world is now, with its, you know, frantic distractions that they're engaged in, as they're, everyone's patting themselves on the back and saying, hey, we're about ready to graduate in a cosmic corporate culture, which is is that throat cough? Wow. Getting too much resistance there. You feel that? Did you hear that cough? That's anger. Okay. My breathing suddenly got. Assaulted there. That may mean that's, I don't want to go any further in that direction. I was going too far into the upset. Let it be. Let the workings of cosmic culture, let it be. Whatever they want to do, whatever they, how it works out. Let us not critique it too strongly. Just hit like a tornado. the tornadoes, Telstar. Telecommunication satellites, perhaps? Influencing us? I don't know, but that hit like a tornado in my throat. Wow. Extremely powerful. So I just back off that line of talk I was engaged in. It was leading in a socio-political direction. And there's a tremendous, as you felt anger in cough, 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 meaning don't say that. You shouldn't, you know, don't say those things about us. This angers us greatly. Tremendous fear. So I say, oh, okay, there's no need, you know, no need to antagonize those who are going along with cosmic corporate culture. We're not trying to antagonize them. We're just trying to keep reminding ourselves that we don't want to go in that direction. So 1970. What was going on in 1970? Maybe I need to do something, I don't know. All right, very great. Well, I guess that's enough for now. You can see the intensity of what we're dealing with here. It's no joke, as I said on the website. Yes, seriously, this is really happening. Yes, seriously, this is really happening. I mean, this is really serious, intense stuff. So you take a misstep and you're going to, the junkyard dog is going to come after you. You know, you see the dog is growling and you say, hey, you know, I'm a nice person. Here, dog, let me pet you, you know, smell my hand. And the dog, you know, just immediately starts attacking the fence like crazy, you know, trying to furiously bite you. You've probably seen that situation where guard dogs, you know, they'll just be looking at you really intently or growling or whatever. And you think, well, maybe I can, you know, make friends with them. And when you try to do that, that's when they, you know, go at you, well, go berserk. Yeah, you know, fighting dogs really go berserk. So that's like in the throat. I went, tried to go too far. And my throat suddenly, it arose like that. Affects the ability to speak, ability to breathe. You know, it's really quite amazing. People are very uptight. There's some very nervous people in the world with designs. The cosmic corporate culture has a blueprint, and they don't want that blueprint talked about too much. They're very nervous about it. You know, if something should happen to it, they feel that their salvation depends upon it working out the way they want. So let it work out however they want it, but we're going to do our thing. Okay, we're going to have our attention on, you know, this is it. This is it, this is it, this is it. One more time, www.alohawellness.wix.com/this-is-it. And maybe you can pick up some pointers there, homepage there, center bottom, so this is non-dual, the link there, click non-dual. You can read a nice little synopsis I put in about maybe what is it that we're really dealing with here. What is it that we're really dealing with? And be prepared for a wow reaction, okay? All right, very great. We have done a good job here, and we're going to not carry it any further. And I'm going to go in and get something, go inside and warm up. Okay, supposed to warm up in California this next 5, 6 days, high 80s again. This is we're just drying out and like turning, grapes turning into raisins here. Okay, very great. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. What is it that, where is your wow coming from? This is, if I want to hear anything from anyone, where is your wow coming from? And what are you noticing that is just like, hey, something is really going on that is quite profound. Okay, very great. That's it.